Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
It's my great pleasure to be with you tonight. Organizing the BiPolar exhibition has been a long and wondrous journey for me. I have some important acknowledgments. Our deepest thanks goes to the BiPolar artists, Jenna Biggs, Elise Engler, and Itty Neuhaus, for their generosity throughout the planning process and for sharing with us some of their most challenging work, offering unique visions of those extreme regions of the world that most of us will never experience. We are extraordinarily grateful for the support of the exhibition by Dr. Margaret Kerwin, Vice President and Provost, and Dr. Lorna Shaw, Dean of Arts and Humanities. The Visiting Artists Committee has provided funding for tonight's lecture. Thank you to Paul Morin for his encouragement and support regarding so many details related to the installation. The exhibit could not have been realized without the generous assistance of our facilities department. Thank you, John, Mark, Lynn, Ray, James, Rick, Tim, Paul, and everyone who lent their expertise and helped with the installation. And thanks to our capable ITS staff, in particular, Mike Stratton, Adam Zonis, and Rachel Ramsey, for working through all of the technical aspects of the exhibition and the presentations. And thank you to the gallery staff and gallery management students who worked so diligently with Itty Neuhaus and Elise Engler on the installation. Thank you to our graphic design students for their willingness to take on multiple projects for these exhibitions and make countless revisions gracefully. They are Peter Smith, who designed the BiPolar invitation, the Evite, the text wall, the Spectrum Theater ad. So you all have to go to the movies. And you'll see Janet Biggs' Arctic Bang. It is just a phenomenally beautiful image. John Fisher, also a senior graphic design student, who designed the BiPolar artist text panels and Subhankar Banerjee's text panels and labels, and Ken Ragsdale's text panel and labels. And Rob Hendricks, who did the exhibition labels for BiPolar, and Kim Sloderick, who did the BiPolar checklist. Important additions to the BiPolar exhibition are the huge photographs of Subhankar Banerjee, showing in the Atrium Gallery, a native of Calcutta, India. Subhankar Banerjee is a scientist, artist, activist, and author. At the age of 32, he left his job at Boeing to devote his life to the preservation of the Arctic region. The photographs on exhibit are taken from an airplane and are described by the artist as a study of the, quote, representation of the fragility and vulnerability of grand landscapes, end quote. I urge you to look him up online and check out his stunning books. Mr. Banerjee declined our offer to deliver a lecture at St. Rose. He's a very busy man, traveling the world, lecturing and furthering the cause of the Arctic preservation. We gratefully acknowledge Joanna Isaac, John L. Merriam Chair, Department of Art History and Music at Fordham University, for her assistance and support in loaning us Mr. Banerjee's work. And now, about Janet Biggs. Janet Biggs is known primarily for her conceptual work in video, photography, and performance. She explores the tense relationships between athleticism and human ambition, individualism and community, free will and control, and gender stereotypes, ultimately challenging the restraints that cultural systems impose. In regard to the performative aspect of her work, the artist states in a recent interview with Emily Rain, this is a quote, I've hung off the back of a truck inches from the above the ground at more than 100 miles an hour. I've paddled kayaks in the Arctic under huge glacial walls with polar bears swimming nearby. I've squeezed through glacial ice caves so tight that I couldn't get my head up to see with my headlamp. And I've descended into Arctic coal mines where methane fires ignite with terrifying regularity. Fearlessness is a featured virtue in her Arctic trilogy. The artist spent almost 3 months in the Arctic Circle to recreate these single channel videos on exhibition. Fate to White projects a solitary explorer who journeys amidst ice floes and polar bears aboard an antique schooner and kayak while ghostly glimpses. A performance artist, John Kelly, appears singing a mournful Baroque Italian madrigal. In The Cold Edge, ventures inside an ice cave that is filled with danger and claustrophobia. Brightness all around takes us beneath the Earth's surface, where laborer Linda Nordberg, a solitary coal miner and machine operator who dons her makeup every day and her diamond earrings, I understand, and enters a dark, suffocating underworld juxtaposed with a powerhouse performer named Bill Coleman. Janet Biggs has been included in major exhibitions and festivals internationally and in the United States, including the European Media Art Festival, Onnesbruck, Germany, Videonale 13 Festival for Contemporary Video Art, the Kunstmuseum Bonn, Germany, and the Miami International Film Festival in Miami. Solo exhibitions include the Musée d'Art Contemporain de Montreal, Quebec, and Connor Smith, Washington, D.C., Tampa Museum of Art in Tampa, Florida, and the Winkelmann Gallery in New York. Awards include the Electronic Media and Film Program at the New York State Council on the Arts Award, the Arctic Circle Fellowship Residency, the Experimental Television Center in New York, and the National Endowment for the Arts Fellowship. Biggs is represented by Connor Smith, Washington, D.C., and Winkelmann Gallery, New York. And you can look her up online at janetbiggs.com. And it seemed like I was always chasing her around the world every time I sent her an email. Some of our conversations were taking place while she was in Indonesia working on a project that she just completed, filming in volcanoes in Indonesia, sulfur mines in Indonesian volcanoes. And you may see a little snippet from that. So without further ado, I'm so pleased to introduce to you Janet Biggs.
Unexpected experience to throw both poles together. So I'm loving getting to see what BiPolar production looks like. And found myself walking around the exhibition thinking, I need to go south. I really need to go south. And also realizing that Itty and I are now sharing some possible future passions that have to do with being a bit warmer hanging out inside of volcanoes, so we'll see what happens. But it's probably in the most romantic sense of the phrase that I am going to say, I am seduced by going to the ends of the earth. And that's a hard thing for an artist to confess in many regards, because you don't want to just be seduced. It really isn't all about beauty. Ideas matter tremendously to me. But when it comes to the Arctic, to that region, I can't distance myself from it, which was really interesting to figure out and took me 3 years and 3 months up there, 3 years time overall. But the thing that drew me, I mean, the otherworldliness of that kind of region is unbelievable. But it wasn't just that. It was people, I ended up being fascinated with people that live there full time, the people that can define and defend a sense of who they are in a region that most of us find absolutely unimaginable. They don't just dwell there, they succeed in ways that are totally inspiring to me. So I feel like if nothing else, I'm like an Arctic stalker. I'm constantly looking for somebody that's pushing to extremes and figuring out things that I just couldn't imagine on a full-time basis. And I happily get to live vicariously through their actions on a short-term basis, which is really thrilling. When I went to the Arctic, it was actually, we never really have wanted to go to the Arctic forever, and there was a program that came up called the Arctic Circle Residency. I think it's arcticcircle.org, if any of you are interested, thearcticcircle.org. And it was a pilot program that combined artists and scientists and sent us on a two-masted schooner that was built in 1910. And we started about 500 miles north of the top of Europe on an archipelago that's called Svalbard, or Spitsbergen. One side of it is called Spitsbergen. So some of my favorite statistics, it's 800 miles north of the top of Siberia. It's really north. And we boarded, 18 of us, artists and scientists, boarded this boat and then just set sail and went north. And we kept going until we hit pack ice and couldn't go any further. And it was one of those experiences that, yeah, so you're on a ship with a bunch of artists and scientists, and you're trying to figure out what you can possibly do in a region that you're so privileged to be there. And what that means in terms of, you know, understanding that you're in a region that's disappearing, and in some small regard you're helping it disappear just by your mere presence. At the same time, desperately wanting to be a professional and come out of it with work that you're proud of, work that you know that you're you feel not only expands your voice but possibly allows that region to live for other people in a way that might not happen. And so, as I am wont to do occasionally, I became really, really over-determined and obsessive and an incredible control freak, which in the Arctic doesn't work really well. But I thought, if I'm gonna go on this ship and I'm gonna make a piece, I really wanna do this thing that's gonna be absolutely amazing. So I decided that I would learn how to paddle a kayak, which I'd never learned. It was not a skill I had. And so I joined the kayak polo team in New York because I thought the way that would make me a strong paddler the fastest is to do a full contact sport where people are slamming into my kayak and trying to tip me over. And it worked. I became an okay paddler fairly quickly. And then I had this idea that I was going to orchestrate a kayak ballet in the middle of the Arctic. Because why not, you know? And so I worked with dancers in New York, I worked out choreography, I worked with dancers in Juilliard, I worked out this intricate choreography, worked with the kayak polo team to realize the choreography. I uploaded it, and on the ship we weren't exactly sure of our path because you can't quite determine where you're going to be traveling in the Arctic on a sailboat. So there was an idea that we would probably be at Longyearbyen, which is the main town in this archipelago called Spitsbergen, but there was a chance we might go over to Greenland. And so I sent this choreography kind of off to a couple different regions, saying where I knew that there were Inuit kayakers or that there were Arctic students that paddled, and said, can you guys learn this? And I'll be up soon, and we'll just kind of figure this out and videotape it. And honestly, I really thought that failure would become part of this project, because how can you go to the Arctic and choreograph an Arctic ballet, a kayak ballet? And surprisingly, it worked. I mean, it worked too well. And I had this footage of these paddlers out in the middle, you know, of this unbelievable scenery with icebergs floating by and bearded seals coming up and going, huh? You know, looking at the paddlers, and perfect synchronization. And I will never use that footage ever because it's too beautiful. So everything I thought about going to that region got scrapped. I mean, completely scrapped. And then I was left trying to figure out, now what? Like, now what do I do? And as many artists on board the ship were, I was really suspicious of my romanticism. Um, I you know, I wanted to have some kind of intellectual distance so that I understood, so that I could have the ability to understand the region, understand my place in the region, come up with something that is idea-driven, not just about desire. And I fought it so much. And I divided all of the artists, in my mind, I divided all of the artists on the ship into two categories. And one of us, I called us either the earnest in the Arctic or the ironic in the Arctic. And I clearly was at the earnest camp, if you saw my work. But I thought, you know, there has to be a way to embrace my desire and still figure out some kind of intellectual discourse. Like, what does it mean to be in the Arctic in 2009, 2010, and make beautiful images? So David Caspar Friedrich, circa 2009. You know, what does that mean? And what does it mean to be in a region that, you know, it is that we're losing? When I was up there, I struggled. I shot. I came back to New York. I had the worst culture shock of my life coming back to New York, so I kind of hid out in my studio for the next 3 months. I couldn't go out. There's a joke among people that have gone to this residency that it's the marriage killer. And it's hard to come back to a relationship, to anything that you know after being up there. And it sounds kind of corny, but it's that life-altering to be in that kind of region. And so, you know, while trying to wade through this, I wouldn't even look at my footage. And it wasn't until, I mean, really 6 months later that I could do, you know, go through it in any kind of serious, conscious way. And when I did, I realized I had shot Arctic porn. I mean, it was just like, you couldn't take a bad shot up there. It was so beautiful. And so there I am with Arctic porn in my studio going, Now what? And it took a long time to try and figure out exactly what was happening. So if I had experienced the sublime, which I really did, in the like true Edmund Burke sense of the sublime, that means that I had, you know, I had the destabilization of time. I mean, I really had all that stuff. And if you read my journal, I recorded things that had happened like 3 days in a row, and if you had asked the same thing, and if you had asked me, I would have sworn that yes, that had happened on that day. Like, we hit a big iceberg, like really big. And the crew had run below deck to see if we had breached the hull, which is a fairly big, you know, it's a big event. And then we had really good homemade cookies were brought out just after that big event when you're on the ship in the Arctic. But I had written that it happened on a Tuesday, on Wednesday, and on Thursday. And was completely convinced at the time that I was writing it that had occurred on all those days. So there was something about that region that made me more present than I have ever been in my life. And then, you know, sort of out there in a way that I'd never had either. You know, I looked at a friend's footage of me sitting on the ship, and I had, you know, eyes glazed over, just kind of doing this for a really long time. So it was an interesting, like just a really interesting contradiction constantly up there. So there I am trying to figure out what to do with this Arctic form that I've got in New York, and what to do with this idea of the sublime, and giving over to complete desire, which is ultimately what the first piece that I made, which is called Fade to White, is about. I gave in to the piece, I gave in to my desires. There's that moment for me when a video takes over, or a work, no matter what medium, when it takes over and I feel like I've completely lost control and it's starting to make itself. And that's the best and most terrifying moment in production, in my studio. And it's rare enough that I've learned to embrace it, but it's really scary. And that's kind of what happened with that piece. I was just like, I'm fighting this, I don't want it to be this, and here we are. But I needed to, you know, it's my work. I want to figure out how to, it becomes my voice, not just Arctic porn. And I was really trying to think what could possibly happen. And when I went up, I'd done a lot of research about polar explorers, and I'd also done a lot of research about gender in the Arctic. And there's a lot of information about the early polar explorers that they would stop in to Inuit villages and essentially kidnap Inuit women because they could, and put them on board because they had amazing survival skills that the early polar explorers didn't have. And they would take these women up on their journeys and occasionally, you know, if given the opportunity, often the kidnapped women would flee into the night. And so they coined that as Arctic hysteria, which, you know, is absolutely ridiculous. But it's, you know, so I was thinking about gender and what gender meant in that region, and the person that I'm filming on board, Odin, who's the protagonist in that video, you know, was really, he lives there, he's lived in that region for 12 years, he calls himself an Arctic explorer, he's an ice expert, whatever that means these days, because, you know, that region's completely mapped, so I'm as romantic as he is that, you know, there is still room for discovery, but it is mapped. So if your livelihood is polar explorer, it's just an interesting position to put yourself in. But he is like the stoic uber male, you know, and so no matter where we were and what we're doing, he is this perfectly calm Arctic explorer. So we would be in the kayak in a double paddling under a glacier face that, you know, is many stories tall, and you're pushing yourself through that ice, which meant that it calves fairly regularly. And he would just really quietly say, "If it calves now, we'll die. Are you okay?" in that situation, what are you gonna do? I'm like, you know, okay. So there I have what is a fairly typical view of Arctic maleness, and I really wanted to counter that. And I thought about introducing gender in a, you know, in its opposite, and bringing a woman into the piece, and it just wasn't right. And I was sitting in my studio listening to opera one night, and I thought, oh my God, that's it. Like, the only thing that can match the Arctic is an aria. And I knew that there's a performance artist in New York, his name is John Kelly, and he is the most amazing countertenor I've ever heard. His performances, if you ever have a chance, go. I mean, really, go see him, he's incredible. He also performs in drag. He does a Joni Mitchell that's to die for, that Joni Mitchell loves. But he has that countertenor voice, and he has a presence that is so beautiful and so nuanced in terms of maleness. And I just knew that the only person I could imagine that could match the Arctic would be John Kelly. And so I asked him to sing, and that was a separate collaboration that was really fantastic, you know, to be able to work with him. So the piece is done, and I show the piece. And then I realized that, you know, my work's not done there. Like, I don't get it. I really don't get the Arctic. If the sublime is about awe, I mean, incredible awe, the inverse is terror. And I really didn't experience terror. I mean, I might as well have been wearing Vaseline on my glasses kind of thing. Like, it was that, you know, I was that in love with the region. So I thought, I need to go back. And I contacted the director of the program and begged, convinced, pleaded till he said, okay, come back again. And I went back, and I went back on that ship again. But the second time, in the Arctic, in Svalbard, there are polar bears, which are in the video, and polar bears are true predators of man. So you were required by law out there to carry a high-powered rifle, and this is obviously not because anyone wants people shooting polar bears, it's just actually a way to keep the polar bears safe. So we were, you know, there we are out in this like endless horizon, but we always had to be huddled around the guy or the girl with the gun. And I thought, if I go back, and I want to understand terror, and I want to understand what the fragility of my presence in that region, I can't be huddled around the guy or the girl with the gun all the time. You know, it's just not, it's not coming through. So I took high-powered rifle lessons and learned how to shoot a 30-06 180 grain bullet, and how to shoot a flare gun, and the whole procedure that happens when you're confronted with a bear, which is a little hard to mimic in, you know, Long Island, which is where I was taking lessons. But there is this whole procedure, which is when a bear charges you, you're supposed to do something that redirects, and they encourage you to drop a piece of clothing and then move away. Yeah, exactly. So you're moving away in this white-on-white region. So, you know, in my mind, of course, there's like the slow striptease across the Arctic. But when that doesn't work, you're supposed to shoot a flare into the sky. It's an emergency flare, and anyone that sees that is, it's an emergency flare, they're required to respond. But we're so far north and so far off the grid that no one will ever see this. So I started shooting them off with impunity. I mean, I was, you know, they're beautiful. I would just shoot them all up, all over the place, and was videotaping that. But it made you, you know, so it's a way to make a mark, but it's also a way to acknowledge the futility of, like, of that effort. And then the last moment is, well, there's another kind of flare where you drop it in front of the bear and it makes a really loud bang. And I'm an okay shot, but I can't guarantee if the bear is charging me, I wouldn't drop it behind the bear, which would then. So there were all these dilemmas, but what I really wanted was autonomy, and I wanted autonomy so I could experience that region. I also thought, if I'm so susceptible to the beauty here, then I need to figure out a way to not dwell in that beauty. So I really went back up and spent most of my time underground, which is where Brightness All Around came from. I dropped into ice caves, which you just kind of hike out onto a glacier, and if there's a hole, you put some ice screws in and lower yourself in and try and figure out what's down there, which is really amazing to be someplace that you know nobody's ever been. And then the other time I spent in coal mines, and coal mines are, you know, it's so, the idea of the Arctic disappearing, and my role as an activist, and my relationship to the Arctic is so much more complex than before I went. So I spent time in both, there are two mines up there, one is Russian and one is Norwegian, and the Norwegian is fairly ordered and has pretty good safety systems. And the Russian is completely underfunded, and you notice that they didn't pull the bodies out from the last horrific event that they, the fire that they had in there, and you know, it's just terrifying. But so it gave me, I understand the Arctic terror at this point. I feel like I set up situations to give myself a different kind of experience and fulfilled that. But I still was also interested in gender, and gender up there, I the first time I was up there, I heard this rumor that there was a woman coal miner, and she'd been living up there for 8 years. She's amazing. She's got the hardest job in a coal mine. She's, as soon as they dig a new section, she's the first one in, and she bolts up the ceiling so it's safe for everybody else to come in. And so I found her, again, stalking is a big on my production, and ended up going into this coal mine with her and filming the second piece. And the second piece, you know, there's a really clear binary system happening, right? There's a above and this kind of angelic figure of John Kelly, and then there's the below and the figure of Bill Coleman, who's an amazing performer as well. And I knew I wanted to exploit that, although I didn't want that to be as simplistic as it sounds, so I was hoping that, you know, somehow embracing that, I could find a bit more nuance happening there. And so I interviewed people that had near-death experiences and came up with the lyrics for that. Bill and I worked together, and he composed the music, and you know, I think what happened is it gave me not only the inverse of the first experience, but gave me a completely different understanding about desire, about passion. You know, there's no less desire happening below in that piece from it is as above. And then the last piece, which I kind of refer to as connective tissue between those two binaries, is the piece of the cold edge. And that was shot inside an ice cave. And that was an interesting moment of discovery, a moment when I can kind of screw around with the format a little bit. So it wasn't necessarily a kind of documentary format that a singer interwoven in. I used a different strategy, it's the first time I've ever appeared in my own work, which was both because I had I was certified on the gun, so I could shoot that flare off at the end, but also because I needed to be there. When I talk about being present in the region, I really needed to be present in a way that gave me permission to put myself in the work, which had never happened before. And then, because I needed to warm up, I went to Indonesia next, and shot inside an active volcano for a couple weeks. And how are we doing time? We have time? I think I'm just gonna start the video and let you look for a minute, and then I'll talk on top of it for a minute.
Thank you.
by doing this piece, it brought up questions of choice, obviously. You know, in the Arctic, the people that I'm filming have choice, and choice in a fairly traditional manner. And Avi, who's this minor, you know, there's a degree of choice. His decisions are he can work within this volcano and make slightly more than if he were to work on the government-owned coffee plantation, which means he can support his family, which is why he does this, better than if he were working on the coffee plantation. But it shortens his life expectancy to about 35 or 40 years. And, you know, as an artist, there's a, you know, we become voyeur, or I do. I think my role is really important to be a witness. And it's becoming ever so much more important to my work. And yet I can't, you know, as I was saying, like, there I am in the Arctic and I'm contributing to the demise of the Arctic by my physical presence. And, you know, there's a degree of exploitation to what I do, certainly. And I think the closer I ride that line, probably the better my work is, but it's a ongoing question and dilemma in my process. And I think we can stop there. Thank you.
Sometime in February, and we'll let them know when we make a plan. Elise has hundreds of drawings on exhibit that document her entire journey to Antarctica with the National Science Foundation. She spent 3 days in the gallery creating her frozen landscape wall painting, which is taken from a still image of a glacial ice field and was assisted by my gallery management students. Please don't miss her travelogue video that has been distilled down to 18 minutes for more than 200 hours of actual footage. I remember sending her emails, Elise, are you done yet? Do you have a title? Is it, do you know how long it is? Are you finished yet? She's amazing. We'll visit Shackleton's hut in the video. You'll see lots of penguins and watch Elise create the art that's on exhibit right here on the ice. You will also see her handmade books displayed with the originals on one side of the case and the first edition prints on the other side. She's an extraordinarily prolific and thoughtful artist. For additional images and information, you can visit her website. Itty Neuhaus is a sculptor who combines the aesthetics of drawing, photography, video, and installation to refer to changing states of matter, bringing together global and personal forms of change. Her recent work addresses geological and environmental concerns as seen in the subarctic landscapes of Newfoundland and Labrador. The starting point for the work began with trips to two geologically significant landscapes in subarctic Canada. In 5 trips over 8 years, the artist acquired knowledge and a sense of these places by drawing on site, shooting time-lapse photography and video footage, and researching local geological and meteorological conditions. The artist has exhibited in solo and group shows, including Gallery of Contemporary Art in Slovenia, Black and White Gallery in Brooklyn, the Iceland Art Museum, Spack Mellon Gallery, the Zero Bride Coat Venice, Italy, Sculpture Center, and Long Island City, New York. In 2011, Itty received a Fulbright Fellowship to Newfoundland, which is artist in residence at Muskegon National Park. Additional awards include the McDowell Colony and the Otto Artist Residencies, the New York Foundation for the Arts Special Opportunity Stipends, Paula Krasner Foundation Grant, Culture Space Funded Residency, and the Muskegon National Studio Program. On January 7th, Itty began her complex installation, Understory, and worked with dozens of my gallery students, facilities, and ITS staff for a very challenging and engaging 2 weeks. While commuting from her artist residency at Yaddo, probably more like sneaking out. It was an amazing 2 weeks. I have to say, I've never seen so many people in the gallery working at once. In my tenure at Masry, it was quite remarkable. And what a wonderful team we had. And Itty was in good spirits throughout the entire process, thank goodness. I probably can't say the same thing for myself, but we managed quite well. It was an amazing experience for us. And on that note, I'd like to welcome Itty Neuhaus.
She and I met at McDowell, and she
was a snow angel model, and she was composed, for orchestra, almost 100 compositions, and somehow took on my tweaky little ice sounds that I got from a another very wonderful artist, Katie Patterson. I heard her interviewed on NPR. She recorded the, she had a hydrophone on the underside of an iceberg, and she had the work in a gallery exhibited. The work was just a phone number. You dial that phone number, so she worked with the Iceland phone company. And you dial the phone number, and you just get a live feed from the underside of the iceberg in Iceland. So I called, I got in touch with Katie Patterson. I tried to make my own hydrophone, and I went to the, you know, subarctic, and I recorded icebergs, and it was like, you know, all the like banging. It was actually with a microphone with a condom over it. You know, make your own microphone. It was very funky, and but it didn't work. So I went to, you know, she's like had the right technical stuff. So Katie Patterson gave me this little like whatever 9-second snippet of ice sound of basically prehistoric, the air from prehistory releasing into the Gulf Stream current as this iceberg melts. So, you know, these 9 seconds of that, you know, it sounds like Alka-Seltzer, basically. My husband's Gulf shop, I'm also gonna thank. Said, why do you have to go all the way up there? Why don't you just like in our bathtub, do some Alka-Seltzer, and you don't even know? There's something about the authentic, so took those 9 seconds, gave them to Andrea. On her way to the Himalayas, she somehow gets into the studio, she composes for major orchestra, you know, major orchestral compositions. So she made this little piece for me, for my piece, and she made this plunge, and, you know, did this amazing work, so I wanted to thank Andrea. And she made her way here to the island where she is working on an incredible opera, first opera on based on the 12th century Tibetan saint Norepa, and so anyway, I'm incredibly dead. And I am sort of a composer, whatever. Slot about it. There's another composer that I met also worked out another year, and I want to thank her. She's not here. But her name is Ule Martinite. She's Lithuanian, and she wrote a piece called The Sound in the Other Piece, called Completely Embraced by the Beauty of Emptiness. And she composed that around soon after the death of her father, and we were both at the Dow, kind of, you know, taking shelter from having recently gone through the death of our parent. And so she and I empathized with that. And I also want to thank Newfoundland, Research and Creative Awards, Corporation Yaddo, McDowell, and Fulbright Foundation. My family, my incredible family, my two sisters have flown in from Oregon. They are the Brigettes, that you'll see swimming in the lake, and my father, who's here from New Jersey, and my cousins. They were swimming in that lake, and they endured a lot of hardship as I directed them with these heavy masks and tying them up and all this insanity in this bowl. And all this work is, you know, after Janet's talk, I sort of wanted to just throw this whole thing out because I'm so impressed by your attitude towards this incredible place. It, you know, how you talk about the porn, the Arctic porn, and this idea of just being, you know, yeah, who isn't attracted to the Arctic? You know, like, who doesn't want to go and sit? And maybe there are people that don't want to, but it's really incredibly beautiful. And just to sit on a bluff and watch an iceberg melt is not, it's just a wonderful thing. And but it so much has to do with death, and it has to do with what I appreciated so much about Janet's talk was this idea of death and beauty and sublime, and it really, you cannot be in a place like that and not think about your own demise. And you know, I do this thing, you're not supposed to do this, but I sort of anthropomorphize the icebergs a lot, and I'm like, what would they want, and you know, what do they think of me? But they are, they are weaving, and they are old, and they are witnesses of something that is profound. And so just watching and witnessing and trying to present that incredible phenomenon, it's like, hey, look, this iceberg is here, and it's changing, and it's going to never be the same. And gosh, I've got my camera aimed on it. How fortunate. That's sort of what I feel. So all this work is dedicated to my mother, who died while I was working on this work, kind of suddenly. And and a lot of, literal poetry, she was very, she could reel off poems. One of the pieces, the flat art pieces, as you enter, is a lighthouse. It's called Whelmed in Deeper Gulfs with Words. And as I was looking at that title tonight, I was like, yeah, Whelmed in Deeper Gulfs with Words. But the words kind of whelmed, it's a poem that as she was, she was like, oh, you should. I was writing all these words that had to do with the sky and the ocean and polar exploration and first sightings of icebergs on that piece. And she said, oh, well, there's this William Cowper poem. And she started reciting it. And my father probably was like, oh, well, then the next line is such and such. They would do this sort of tag team thing with poetry. They just had that way of reciting poetry. So death is a very large theme for, it sort of sideswiped me in the production of this work. I was going to the Arctic because it all started, actually, with this article I read in New Yorker by John McPhee called Cooling the Lava. And it was about a physicist in Iceland who, in 1973, Heimaey was erupting off the south coast of Iceland, and as this was erupting, it was threatening the major harbor of Iceland, and massive efforts were. I mean, this was the mainstay of the economy of Iceland, and as it was erupting, it wasn't one of those like dramatic, like flattened Pompeii kind of, everyone like frozen in their tracks. It was very slow and just insidious. And what do we do about this? How are we going to say, we just watch this, our homes and our lives just be engulfed? And so this physicist was walking along the beach and he saw this trickle of lava going down the beach, across the beach, and then he noticed that as it hit the ocean, it took a left turn, and it was being cooled. A wall was forming. So he thought, apply water to lava, can you change the direction? Can you sculpt the earth, basically? Sculpting the earth. I like sculpture. I like sculpting on a big scale. That's my kind of scale. So I thought, okay, well, so what ended up happening was he started with the water mains of the town. People said, he was crazy, actually. They thought, you cannot stop Mother Nature. You can't. This is unstoppable. They called it something. Excuse me, if anyone speaks Icelandic, I'm butchering it, but it's called something like pissor on bron, which is pissing on the lava. And they thought this is like ridiculous. Well, somehow suddenly it started to work. Wait, the lava's moving. So let's, let's put some more resources. And he eventually got larger and larger. He got pipelines from the Alaska pipeline he was going through, international support. More and more, giant cannons of water were being, directed on the lava, and ultimately it worked. He was able to actually sculpt this lava around so that got me interested in sculpting, And so my husband, who was my boyfriend at the time, had been there as a teenager with his father who worked with Air Canada, and had gone to see this newly erupting iceberg, and we decided we were going to apply for a residency, and we went to a residency there. It was this kind of bring your own light bulb, kind of really funky residency, and we went there, and we basically traveled the whole ring road, and then that was the start of, I think, 5 trips. I think our last trip was on our honeymoon, or the next last trip, but we went back 5 times, and So in that, so that started me going, you know, to this geologically active place and making work about. Then the next kind of story, this is basically a bunch of stories that kind of propelled me through these landscapes. We went to the largest, Europe's largest glacier while we were there. I was interested in geothermal activity. We wanted to like pick up like the world's newest rocks and, you know, like be in a place where it was a brand new mountain, and we did that. And then as we were traveling around, we went to this glacier. We heard about this volcanic activity under the glacier, and that there was geothermal activity under the glacier. And I loved this idea that this like ancient ice was pressing down on these forces of heat that were somehow in conflict. And there was so that got me going. And our tour guide actually at the time was told us this story that was actually turned out to be fabrication. But what happened was there was a filmmaker filming like the lake. You know, we all like take our cameras and we're like, "Ooh, cool!" You know, like, walking along, and he basically walked back into a crevasse and fell down more than 40 meters because his team had 40 meters of rope with them, and then they couldn't reach him where he was. They could hear him; he was down there, so they had to go back and get more rope. And when they came back, he had drowned in this warm water. Warm water under the ice. How, you know, whoa. And so I ended up, you know, this was like, okay, I've got to start doing work about this. And so this is back to like, this work all has to do with death. Because you're in this beautiful place and you just lose track. And you're all often at the edge and you just want to go. You know, it's like there's this, I think it's called foror vacui, but there's also this vagina dentata. There's this kind of like, desire to go into these abysses. And so I've always been attracted to the abyss. So how did I get to Labrador and Newfoundland? As I was flying over to Iceland over and over again, I would see these things from the, I don't know if you've flown that route, you see the, from the air, you see Greenland and the entire ice cap, and you get a sense of the whole top of the globe. It's quite amazing. And I'm always like at the window seat, looking at the window. And yeah, you see the rain, it's terrible footage. But anyway, I saw these icebergs close to land, and I wanted to film them. And so that was Newfoundland, and got applied to a residency, blah, 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 or a Fulbright, and get it, and go there, and then sit on a bluff and watch icebergs melt. That's basically my interest. And so I wanted to see them change. I got interested in this proverbial, you know, the tip of the iceberg, what's going on under the surface, and the idea that there's something changing and destabilizing this mass that we don't understand. And I got hooked up with an engineer, Steve Bruneau, who put me in touch with an oceanographer who dived under icebergs, and in touch with a whole crew of wild and wacky cowboys of the ice who go and dynamite wall of icebergs and collect the water for vodka, actually, and for water that gets to buy. So talk about wasteful, and Jenna talked about this, about how you like your presence, your very presence, your idea of witnessing is, you know, very questionable. So I traveled with this iceberg vodka crew, watched them aim giant cannons at icebergs and blow them up, and harvest them. And one of the crew members actually drowned between the two trips that I went with them. And I did a memorial piece for him, and he drowned, like, you know, just going out one night drinking and came back to the boat and fell overboard and drowned. It was so pointless. But I'd done, you know, some sort of documentary footage with him as we were waiting to find icebergs and before finding them. And so this I, you know, I also have this very fraught relationship with the these beautiful, you know, this water, pure. I have an uncle who lived in Alaska, and he talked about how these caravans of Airstream trailers, you know, retired people were seeing the world, would drive up to the glacier park and they would chip off pieces of the iceberg and then try and put them in their cooler and bring them back to, you know, have glacier punch and that the prehistoric microorganisms would open up in the bellies of these, like, tourists that were so gross, and you thought that was the revenge of the icebergs. And so the, I guess, could you play that video? There's a sense that there's a sort of kind of, there's two stories going on here. There's the story of the Earth, there's the story of climate change, human contribution to climate change, and there's sort of my personal experience with the idea of, you know, this beautiful phenomenon. So what you're looking at here is, for the first time ever, right side up, and not vertical, this is a video that's in that large enclosure, and this is a kind of a combination of footage that I shot. This is in Labrador 2 summers ago, and so I basically sat and watched an iceberg change, and I was also sort of trying to reckon with what was going on under the surface of that iceberg, because every day I would come back and it would be changed. And so I superimposed these images of
somebody asked me recently, you did nothing, how did you learn the facts alone? Well, I think I always knew because of kittens and cats.
So I guess I'm sort of, you know, equating human life and the body and sensuous encounters with warmth and cool and with this unknown underside. I don't really understand it, that's really new work. And again, I was thanking Jean for thanking me, for allowing me to, or enabling me to make this work. So I now I'm getting really stupid because I'm looking at work that I don't really quite understand yet. So we'll just play it once and get it over with. And this is sort of these icebergs superimposed are attached to the nets that actually appear in the gallery. And so we did this performance, and it's basically sisters and cousins and daughters of cousins swimming in wetsuits. And this was the place where we scattered my mother's ashes, and I had a sort of, I don't know, some kind of sense of this piece as I was out on the boat, and it kind of looked like this as I was watching the ashes kind of mixed with the sun and the water. And this was a lake that she loved and swam in her whole life. And I somehow wanted to bring these fake icebergs that are blue foam insulation, but I wanted to somehow collide these two experiences, so I did. And then this experience was sitting on a bluff, you know, like wrecking my knees, climbing, taking a boat every day with a walkie-talkie from Battle Harbor, Labrador. They would take me out in a boat, leave me there with a walkie-talkie. It's a mile out in the Labrador Sea. I would climb this crazy bluff with my tripods and all my equipment, and I'd just sit there. And the weather was just horrible. It never, like, I saw that iceberg probably like 1/16th of the time of the 3 days I was sitting there. It would just like be fog. I'm like, it's gone. There's no iceberg out there. And then the sun would break and be like, oh, there it is. And then it would be gone. And I just sat there, for 4 days. And and just, you know, drew and waited. And basically, I was wanting it to flip. I'm like the action. I want, like, iceberg action. I want the iceberg to, I want to see that thing flip. And so I'm sitting there waiting for this giant change, and I'm with an intervalometer, I'm like, you know, filming the thing, and it's going like, oh, well, there's a bird landing, and now a shadow, woohoo! Then I'd come back the next day, and it'd be completely different, and I would have missed the flipping again. So basically, these last few pieces have been about waiting for the thing to really radically change, because that's what I'm interested in. And but the iceberg doesn't necessarily cooperate unless you have, like, you know, torpedoes and guns, and I'm, you know, not going to do that unless somebody's there with a gun that, or Janet, maybe you can get Janet to come blow up an iceberg. But, you know, I mean, that, you know, it sounds really irresponsible, you know, just whatever, just kind of about blowing up icebergs. When I say blowing up icebergs, I mean, there were, like, headlines in the Newfoundland press about this cowboy of the ice that I was traveling with, who, you know, they were like chasing him out of town, and you know, his claim is that the amount of water that melts off into the Gulf Stream current, which is a lot warmer than the you know, as they travel down, it's futile. That iceberg is doomed. It's water, basically, as it travels down. So if he is, you know, causing its quicker demise, it's not a problem. It would have melted off into the sea anyway, and he's, you know, somehow using it for vodka. But anyway, I wasn't necessarily going to talk about that, but I decided it's because of, you know, Janet was talking about this sort of conflicted relationship with the Arctic, and it is such a fraught place. And to have the opportunity to witness this incredibly rapidly changing phenomenon is so such a gift. And you know, I'm interested in that slow change. I'm not, you know, I would like to see it flip, and I'd like to dive underneath, and I'd like to see this amazing phenomena. Because I think I equate so much, you know, I you know, there's this idea of the world and the heavens and the, you know, the weather and these larger systems, but I completely sort of superimpose my own piddly existence and the own, like, my core of my being into the core of the earth. So that when the earth's mantle, if I'm one sort of whole chapter that I left out was the piece that you see overhead in that large nest is, I spent 4 months in Baltimore National Park in a place called, it's called the Tablelands, and it's one of the only places in the world where you can see the earth's mantle on the surface of the earth, and it's this incredible iron-colored, vast mountain, flat, that nothing grows on. So that's what's sort of framing that place overhead, and it's basically the sky over that landscape. And I got really interested in that volcanic core, and sort of thinking about, I don't know, sounds presumptuous, but my own sort of being, my own core, in relation to that core, and really wanting, you know, sort of kind of interested in journeys to the center of the earth and hollow earth theory, knowing about these wacko people who 100 years ago thought that there was, like, a better life inside the earth. So I also am interested in volcanoes, and I'm going to Guatemala with my sister here, who's traveled here from Oregon. My two sisters are both here, and we're going to, and my husband Bill, we're going to go to Guatemala and film, I'm filming Pacaya, an active volcano. I was there doing this month, actually. I was there 4 years ago and filmed, you know, really blurry because I was, like, you know, just awestruck and stupid with the camera. And you know, I was filming this lava right there. And, you know, it was like the guy on the trip had a wet, you know, sweaty t-shirt. Threw it into the lava and just trying to, you know. So it's very unregulated, so I'm looking forward to getting really close. So I'm also interested in this sort of, you know, going to a warmer place. I don't handle the cold as well as I used to after 10 or so trips to Iceland and Newfoundland. And you know, exploring that the other side, the hot. So I think I'll wrap it up now. Thank you very much.
That's something I do, and I separate it from my work and my production. I think that my strongest voice is when I can go in there and find some kind of poetry. What about you, activism?
Sir Walter Grenfell one of the first medical doctors to explore that region and bring, you know, advanced medical care to remote areas, and founded a hospital. It's been continuously fished for since the Renaissance. It's a sort of summer fishing ground. It's like the United Nations of people fishing. And I just found this because there were icebergs nearby, so I have this kind of like, oh, I'm just going to seize this imagery. And then I come to this place where people, like you said, people live, and people, you know, it's prosper or die because of what's going on with the fisheries, and you know, learning about Canada and the politics of Canada, and how politicized Canadian people are, and how involved and activist they are, and how, you know, there's such a, there's all this exploitation going on in the, Newfoundland is like the, you know, the bastard of Canada, and how there's all these people going to the tar sands, and there's pipelines going through, and, you know, these people profit, you know, need to make a living, and you know, people dying on oil rigs, and so I find the, you know, the activism is very, personal level, it's just in terms of who I know, who I meet, can I help anyway, in any way as I go. But I'm less involved politically than you know I might be. I would say.
I have a question about for both of you. Both speak about the inner work that does not mean happens out there. And you both search for action. What if you're waiting for us to do something? And that's the case where she's placing people who are being very active. Who seems to be exactly the opposite of what you're experiencing. So sitting on the block.
I think for me the region is so full of contradictions that it seemed completely reasonable to impose an action out of the region. When I was doing research before I went up, I was looking at polar explorers, and there were two that kept sticking in my brain. One of them is S.A. Andre, a Swedish explorer who, you know, the very idea of reaching the pole is the, you know, the epitome of hubris and direct action. And yet his methodology was to get in a 100-foot-tall balloon and float there. And I thought that was so beautiful that, you know, there's this human impulse to impose yourself in such a concrete way on a region. But then that final moment when you're attempting to do it, you give over completely, and it becomes almost inaction or waiting. And the same with Fridtjof Nansen, also trying to reach the pole, took his ship and froze it into the ice, and then just waited for the currents to carry him there, which they never did. So those are the kind of moments and the contradictions that happen in that region, and I think that's what, in some ways, gave me permission to. You know, to sort of flex my human muscles and try and impose things on the region myself.
Yeah, I don't know if I said nothing happens, but I think so much is happening without it being noticed or that's what just amazes me, that there's this grand drama occurring as these icebergs calf off the polar ice cap and travel down into the Gulf Stream current, and that there's very few people witnessing it. Yes, there's, you know, fishermen are imperiled by them, or there's iceberg tourism, which is a strange and growing field, and you know, people harvesting ice, you know, for vodka production. But I wouldn't say nothing's happening. I would say a lot is happening. One of this engineer that I met, Steve Pinot, helped me up with a lot of the people in Newfoundland. He designs oil rigs and boat hulls for to be impervious to iceberg impact. And we're at the 100th year anniversary of the Titanic. I mean, a lot happens when humans interact with these large forms. It's dangerous. So much is happening, and it's what I think is just incredible is there's so much action, and that icebergs are these kind of harbingers of change, and these kind of forms that are not affiliated with any national alliance, and they just travel and they do their thing, and they are showing us that the ice cap is melting, and so I think there's a lot going on, and then by recording it, I mean, I think some of my position is that by recording it, I mean, the sort of absurdity of me, waiting for okay, iceberg, perform for me, that the absurdity of that this idea of recording something in the act of changing or dissolving or, it's just this. I just feel like it's my duty or my role is somehow to witness this rapid change and make it evident, So, that's a question.
It's a whole way job.
Yeah.
We're just waiting.
Till the icebergs come down the Hudson. Somebody who couldn't get to those places without this funding and whose lives would be radically changed, all you have to do is learn how to write a proposal that is compelling. You tell your story, you say, I have to go there. I don't know what I'm going to find, but I have to go there and I have to. It's about me going there and seeing this for this very specific reason. If you can make a compelling argument, you will get there. There's people out there that want get you to those places. And so you just start researching, traveling fellowship for students, and learn how to write a compelling proposal, and you will get there. People want to give you money to go there.
I was recently on a panel, and the moderator made a comment about me being an artist of privilege because I get to travel all over the world. And my resources are not privileged at all, and I'll spend years trying to write for grants, hit up every corporation I could possibly think of that might have a tie-in and might give me some money, work day jobs if need be to amass money to travel. And so if you're passionate about it, you'll definitely find a way to do it. Don't be discouraged. It's worth it.
And the corporate route is really interesting because corporations like Exxon, after the Valdez disaster, Exxon was doing unbelievable guilt work, and every PBS beautiful dance performance was like Exxon, we're the good guys now, if you can hook into corporations that are exploiting a region, for instance, and And you want to get to that place because you want to do something benign or artful. They'll want to fund you because you'll make them look good. You can sleep well at night with that. But that's another, the idea of calling up a corporation and saying, I know that you do, work in this area, and I'm a student, and it's like, it looks great for them. Imagine you, pretty you, young, fresh, inspiration, on their newsletter. It helps them. They need you.
Just saw a banner that was hanging outside a museum for a show of mine, and he's like, I'm looking good. So there is a kind of interaction that can happen. But Abi, the miner inside the volcano, is almost impossible. There is a guy that I've sent images to, and he'll print them out, and he'll run up the volcano, run into the volcano, and show them to him so he knows what's happening. But I feel like I don't have an interaction, which I really would, I would love to.
It's I had some contact with Inuit First Nations people. Some of the people on the crew that boat that does the iceberg harvesting. Were Inuit people, and it was just fascinating. There's been no road up into Labrador for until recently, and there's cars sitting, like you see car sitting on the edge of the, when you dock, and there's no road there, and like, what's that car? It's like waiting for the road, and so. But in terms of like my art in relation to the people there, I wasn't making work directly. I wasn't choreographing things. The people that helped me in Labrador were Scottish descent. They were Inuit peoples, but they were fascinated and very interested in this work that I was doing. Want to see the end result and stuff like that. And I try to send it out when I finish pieces.
Yeah, there's a kind of generosity that I found that was surprising, because essentially we're coming into a region without, we are artist tourists, and we're coming in and essentially doing pretty absurd things. But there was a real generosity and a desire for conversation. Yes, but becoming more frequent. It's not a huge population of artist tourists that are traveling around the world or up north. But I don't know. Did you?
This new industry, this relatively new iceberg tourism industry. Just a sort of quote flowed into the surface where these people that I've been working with who travel out into these iceberg, little areas. This guy who's taking people on ferry out to Battle Harbor, Labrador, in the Labrador Sea. He said, I was filming some of the footage I was filming from the boat of this iceberg, he would do an express or gratuitous circle around the iceberg. And some of the footage, a local person took me on a little putt-putt boat, like right up close to the iceberg. And that's when I was trying to record the sound of ice and the condom, the mic and the condom, and it wasn't working so well. But, you know, I was also filming, and that's where the snow angel disappears into the iceberg. That's getting up close to the iceberg. And, these people are like, gosh, my father and my grandfather, they were all fishermen, and they were all avoiding these icebergs. And here we're making money, like, getting people close to them. Isn't that absurd and strange, you know? And so that's just a comment that I've heard that several times, like, because I was always like, I want to get closer, and I'm getting closer, and they're like, you gotta be careful. And, so that's sort of interface with kind of culture change, I guess. But I also found an incredible generosity that there was this, you probably find this wherever you go. It's like you say, oh, I'm doing an art project. Like, oh, okay. You know, it's like, yeah, I'm taking core samples because I'm going to save the planet. It's like almost as respect. It's like, I'm doing an art project and I want to like climb on that iceberg and, can you help me, keep me safe from dying? And it's like, okay. it just amazes me that art has that credence in the world.
I like what you said about many times from the beauty of the landscape. And I also think that you may work with something as close as mother time, trying to get some intellectual distance. This week we're doing a lot of things with particular students, and
polarize myself, but the more I go on, I really do feel like teaching is integrated into what I do and make. And I think, I think that distance is, students. My husband and I, we're both teaching similar areas, and we're talking about how you can't fool people into being sophisticated when they're not ready, and that if they're really close to the story and attached to it, this is not what you want to hear, Gina, I know. But you want to hear, oh yes, well, I just pull myself into a trance and remember all that stuff I learned in grad school. I do think it's important to be passionate, to dive right in, I feel a little bit, exposed in my own, when I show my work in a setting where I'm teaching, but I feel like that being that, public about the personal and trying to, engage very sophisticated ideas with one's own personal, that to be sort of asking questions while you're making work, I think as a student is a perfect thing to do. And so.
Ever so slightly, not a lot. I think that, I try really hard not to question myself, even if it feels really wrong and I know better than to go there, which is sort of what I was talking about in terms of wanting to distance. So I think when you're actually making the work, it's essential to explore all of it and never question yourself, no matter how much doubt is part of the process. But then once you taken the photos, taken as much footage as you possibly can, done the painting, then our job as artists, and where I think that it lives or dies, is in your studio, being able to, even though you might have fallen in love with every single image that you've done, to have have the ability to edit. Editing is the unsung skill of every artist, and you need to be able to defend that every single thing must be there and why. And so that would be my words is you need to defend it. You need to really, intent means everything.
Does it ever end? I mean, when you finish a piece, we were talking about this earlier. Watching they do it together. You're still working through that.
I mean, happily for me, it doesn't end, or I wouldn't be making work. I mean, it's, you know, it might end for that one piece because God has to, because of practical considerations, but that thread and that thought process doesn't end. It hopefully generates the next one.
Yeah, just one more question that I'm looking at.
Actually, I went to NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Agency out on Long Island, and filmed a balloon launch, which they do. It's a weather balloon launch. It's an information gathering launch, which is done all over the world at the same time, so we can gather information in a different way. And the reason I used it, I used that image for a few reasons. I think that there's a kind of poetry to launching a balloon that fulfills that romantic side of me, that talks about escape, that talks about promise, that talks about, certainly for the people in that horrific conditions that the human spirit doesn't stop. There are ways to transcend, even if it's just in terms of your own mind or spirit. But I also used it because I think there's this promise of science that we in the Western world assume applies everywhere, and there's so much in the world where it doesn't apply. So I wanted to talk about both sides of that.
Yeah, I think that's a great